Good morning and welcome to the Regional Supervisors Meeting. My name is Tammy Weibel. I work with the division, usually doing technical assistance for counties. And today I am here to introduce the legislative updates meeting. The regional child welfare consultants were gracious enough to give us some time today to speak to you about the legislative changes that went into effect in October. All of your counties have already received a letter about all the changes, all the legislative changes that went into effect October 1st. Today's meeting is really about giving you the opportunity to hear from the North Carolina DSS policy consultants about what changes the laws brought about. So we'll be talking about what the law is, what changes the law brought about, and then how policy will be written. We're not actually going to be showing the exact policy and how it will appear in the manual today. And people, what we learned in yesterday's regional meeting, people had a lot of questions about that. We can't start writing policy until the law has actually been signed, because sometimes the law changes literally right up until the day that it passes. And so we can't start writing policy until we know exactly how the law is going to be written. And then when we are writing policy, sometimes what seems like one simple law changes several other things in the policy manual. We have to make sure that our policy manual is aligning. In addition, one of the benefits of having the five design teams that we have is that we get the opportunity to run changes in policy past the design teams for their feedback. Those design teams, for those of you who don't know, they are made up of staff from the counties and stakeholders. So that gives us an opportunity to get feedback about our proposed policy changes before we actually put them into the manual. So we are currently in that process. We've written a draft for the policy manual. We're having it reviewed with the design team before it goes into the policy manual. So what you're going to hear today is how we're proposing the manual to be rewritten, and then also kind of the theme and the intent of the manual. Today you're also going to feel like you're hearing a whole lot of changes in a short amount of time. But I really want you to pay attention to what it is that you're hearing, because a lot of what you're going to hear today is stuff that is already in the manual. So you're going to hear a lot about sibling placement and placing with relatives. And this is all stuff that we've been doing for years, but there is new law about it. And so we're going to talk to you about that, and then we're going to talk to you about how we intend to write that in the policy manual. So some of it's going to feel really overwhelming because it's going to sound like a lot, but listen closely. A lot of it is stuff that we've been doing for a long time. So this is an opportunity for you to hear about those changes and share where policy is going with your staff. We will not be answering questions today. We will be taking questions and compiling them together with the questions that we got yesterday, so that we can send out answers to all of them together for all of you who have registered for the webinar, so that everyone's getting the same information back. Also, I will be posing a few questions. When I send them out in the chat, they will appear in your questions pod. So if you get an opportunity, please send us some answers. We're looking for some feedback on a few items that I'll be posing during the webinar. Get an opportunity, please go ahead and answer those questions. I think that's all that I have for an introduction. I'm going to turn this over to Amanda Hubbard, one of our policy consultants, and she will start. We have broken this down into the changes that impact safety and prevention, the changes that impact permanency planning, and then regulatory and then mental health changes. And all three of our policy consultants are going to be giving a different piece of this, and they will introduce the legislation that they're talking about and the particular policy area as they speak. So Amanda, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thank you, Emmy. Good morning, everyone. I'm Amanda Hubbard. My role at the division is a program consultant, and I work with the policy for safety and prevention. So that covers intake, assessments, and in-home. Next slide, Jay. So this morning, I'm going to go through the safety and prevention changes. So what you'll see on the CPS side. And Scotty Knight is going to go through the permanency planning section, and then Mary Tour is going to go through the mental health changes for foster youth. So you'll see the session law multiple times broken up throughout each section so that we could group it to make it a little easier to process. Thank you, Jay. So House Bill 132 was the revisions to the juvenile code. It's the recommendations of the court improvement program. And it became session law 2021-100. And so they have included a statutory relative definition. And it's any individual directly related to the child by blood, marriage, or adoption. And so that is going to go into the policy manual directly, just as it's written in the law. And that definition is going to be helpful when you're talking about diligent efforts. Medication-assisted treatment, there is now a law that the statutory definition for medication-assisted treatment as well. It's the use of pharmacological medications that are administered, dispensed, and prescribed by a medical provider in combination with therapy. And so the law was designed to require courts to consider those individuals compliant with services, and so that they're not ordering them to do something different from what their medical providers are recommending. Our policy is going to, we have already quite a bit of information about medication assistant treatment in the assessment manual. And so we'll just be including the statutory definition in there, as well as expanding that section to talk about the caretakers being compliant with services when they're engaged properly with MAT. This isn't going to negate the responsibility of the worker to assess for the safety, the risk of harm, and that parent's capacity to keep that child safe. Those things are much broader than just following through with medication-assisted treatment. And so even if the worker is unable to get those records, either because the parent is not compliant with services or because the provider won't give that information out, they'll still be able to complete their assessment doing the things that they would normally do without that information. Next slide. Okay. Session law 2021-132 was Senate Bill 693. And so it clarifies the definition for neglect. It doesn't change the context. The things that are defined as neglect are exactly the same. It just makes the definition more concise. So it gets rid of a lot of some of the extra wording that's in there. And so that's the way that it will look going forward in the manual. this session law also gives General Assembly members and Joint Oversight Committee members access to confidential CPS records. There are still federal and state laws about certain things that they cannot get with those records. And so what the policy will reflect is that when those requests are made by an assembly member or by joint oversight committee member, that committees, that the counties are going to send those requests to their regional child welfare consultants so that the counties can work with the division to coordinate a response to them to make sure that what they're getting is what they're supposed to get and what they need to get to do whatever it is that they're requesting the records for. RAL notification. So that the law with regards to RAL notifications has changed It's designed to create a safer process for workers who have to make RIL notifications to non-caretakers who've been substantiated for abuse related to human trafficking. So the law requires now that the worker work with law enforcement and their local DA office to determine the safest way to make that notification. And it also allows several caveats. So if there are, if it will cause mental health or physical harm to or danger to the juvenile, it will undermine an ongoing or future criminal investigation or jeopardize the state's ability to prosecute that particular individual, then the worker can make note of that in their documentation and they do not need to make that notification. So the policy will reflect that addition. One of the other things that we are working to do in trying to make the manual easier to process through for workers is to add the RIL notification process itself into the assessment manual. So this will be added along with additional information about the RIL notification process. But none of that will be new information. It's the same process. It will just be found in the assessment manual. So there's been an addition with regards to diligent efforts, and it's just an addition to the due diligence or diligent effort work that we were already supposed to be doing with locating relatives. And so now the law requires that diligent efforts be made to locate and notify relatives and other persons with legal custody of a sibling for a juvenile in non-secure custody within 30 days of removal. The policy already includes a requirement about diligent efforts for children in custody. And so this is where the relative definition will, that new statutory definition will be helpful. The shift that we're making in policy is that we're going to be requiring those diligent efforts much earlier in the process and more consistently in the process. So our goal is for intake workers to be asking those reporters about relatives from the beginning, because when we engage relatives, we know that families and children have better outcomes because they have the support that they need. So we'll also be doing additional guidance or adding additional guidance about using safety circles to build those safety networks or support teams for those families so that they will have what they need. And this is in line with the state's transformation and moving towards a safety organized practice. The engagement of those relatives earlier on and more consistently is going to ensure that children are able to stay with their families and they can be placed in kinship care with relatives when their parents are not able to provide that care for them. Next slide, Jay. So these are some upcoming changes or additional changes that you'll see in policy. Session law 2021-123 was the DJJ bill, and it adds to the neglect definition a parent, guardian, or custodian who has refused to follow the recommendations of the juvenile and family team pursuant to Article 27A. This will become effective on December 1st. So this one, the previous ones that I addressed became effective on October 1st, but this one will become effective on December 1st. So we'll be adding this as part of that process because before the end of the year, it will be effective. To give some context for this particular section, it's referring to vulnerable juveniles. So, and they're defined in statute as children between the age or juveniles between the age of 6 and 10. Who haven't had any prior offenses and haven't been adjudicated as delinquent. They've added this section to try and put services in place for those juveniles to attempt to engage them in services and hopefully keep them out of the system or move them away from the DJJ system. So our policy will address reports that are made regarding parents' refusal to cooperate in the juvenile family team. So that's where the recommendations for services are going to come from. And it'll include things like parenting and mental health services, either for the child and the parent or just for one or the other. But when that refusal to cooperate with those services by the parent impacts the safety of that child or puts them at substantial risk of harm, that's when we're going to be accepting those reports. So not much has changed about that. And so for juveniles who are in the criminal justice system that are over the age of 10, if it creates substantial risk of harm, or they've been subjected to maltreatment, we'll still be accepting those reports. One of the things that we are attempting to do in this space is also provide additional guidance on the worker's role when they are working with these cases and working alongside DJJ, because DJJ has a job to do and they've recommended these services. And so how can we make sure that this child is safe while they provide these services, and what that role looks like? We'll try and go into some more detail to try and help make that clearer. Session law, we've talked a little bit already about session law 2021-132. One of the other components of it that's not due until September 1st, 2022 is the plan. We're going to create a plan for a statewide CPS hotline so that we can centralize intake reporting. It's important to this group because the planning must include at least three counties. That's what the law says. And I know that we would like to include more, if possible, in that process of developing a plan. So that's all the stuff that is related to safety and prevention. Jay, next slide. Scotty, you're up.
Amanda, this is Emmy, I'm sorry. Before we go to Scotty, can I add a clarification on that last slide?
Please do.
Hey, can you go back one slide? So the addition that Amanda was talking about to the neglect definition about children ages 6 to not yet 10 who whose parents are not cooperating with a DJJ in their review meeting. Initially, when that law was being proposed, there was talk about that if DJJ was involved, they wanted to be able to make a report to the county, and the county must initiate an investigation based on that. And we worked with them to try to alter that, to say that you can't do that. There needs to be an allegation of maltreatment, that you can't just call DSS and say, we want an investigation done on a family, that's not how our laws work. And so this was the end product of this. So you can see where we can work with laws, and it doesn't always come out exactly how we might have intended. But the intent behind this is that the family's lack of cooperation with DJJ is placing that child at risk of maltreatment. And so if you really think about that in the scope of how we've always done our work, like Amanda said, that really hasn't changed. So although this particular segment of the definition does have an age to it, we've always done that. If a child has been placed at risk for maltreatment, we've always accepted the report. So whether this kid is involved in DJJ and they're 13 years old and the parents' lack of cooperation with DJJ places that child at risk of maltreatment, we've always accepted that report. If they're 7 years old and they're involved in DJJ and their parents lack of cooperation, somehow, you'd have to hear these allegations, but that lack of cooperation is placed that child at risk of maltreatment, we've always accepted that report. That is the definition of neglect. Now they've just attached this to it. And so it feels like a change. They've definitely made a change to the neglect definition. You'll see it written in the neglect definition. But it doesn't really change how we've practiced and what we accept as a report. I just wanted to clarify that a little bit. Hope that makes that clear and understandable. Sorry to interrupt you, Scotty. Please go forward.
All right. Well, thank you, Emmy. Thank you, Amanda. Good morning, everyone. My name is Scotty Knight, and I am the Foster Care and Adoption Policy Consultant for the Permanency Planning Section. As I am sure you guys are very aware, a significant amount of law changes that impact child welfare occurred in the Permanency Planning Section this year. As a result of this, there will be several policy updates. Next slide, please, Jay. Let's get started with sibling placement and contact. As part of Session Law 100, otherwise known as House Bill 132, effective October 1st, DSS must make reasonable efforts to place siblings together unless documentation is provided that this is contrary to their safety or well-being. When siblings are not placed together, frequent visitation and interaction must be allowed unless contrary to their safety and well-being. Courts can order visitation between siblings and any other family members and specify what those reasonable efforts must look like. Now, prior to this legislative change this year, the importance of sibling placement and contact was already outlined in the Permanency Planning Manual. The intent of the new policy will have a greater emphasis on placing juvenile siblings together. And if siblings are not placed together, the County Child Welfare Agency will be documenting and discussing the efforts made to place the juvenile siblings together monthly. In addition, if siblings are not placed together, the County Child Welfare Agency will be arranging for frequent and ongoing visitation, and the visitation between the siblings will be clarified and documented on the Family Time and Contact Visitation Plan. Juvenile and GAL DSS record access. As part of House Bill 132, Session Law 100, juveniles, even after 18, and their GAL can receive electronic or written copies of DSS records, except those prohibited by law within a reasonable amount of time. The law change is that DSS is required to provide written or electronic copies to the juvenile or GAL if requested within a reasonable amount of time. Prior to this, individuals would likely come to the DSS to review the record. The intent with policy is going to be to update this law change in the policy manual, more than likely cross functions, under confidentiality. 17-year-old juveniles. As part of House Bill 132, Session Law 100, at or before the permanency planning hearing, immediately following a young person's 17th birthday, and at each permanency planning hearing thereafter, the court must be updated on the following. And please keep in mind, this is a very long list. It is currently available when looking up the statute as well. The department's efforts to identify and secure placement options for when that young person turns 18, a list of appropriate adults who can serve as resources for the young person when they turn 18, contact information of the person responsible for overseeing voluntary foster care placements with young adults in the County Department of Social Services with custody or placement responsibility, and in the County Department of Social Services in the county where that young person plans to live at the age of 18. If appropriate, whether that young person has information about how they may contact their siblings, their parents, or their relatives. Whether the department has provided the young person with a point of contact to secure Medicaid and maintain physical and mental health services. Whether the department has provided that young person with information about educational, vocational, or job plans when they turn 18. And whether the department has provided the juvenile with a copy of their birth certificate, social security card, health insurance information, driver's license, or other ID card. also information about how the juvenile may participate in the foster care 18 to 21 program. Now, the intent with policy is going to be to specifically outline all of the required information that I just went over that must be given to the court at the first permanency planning hearing immediately following the juvenile's 17th birthday. Next slide, please, Jay. Foster care 18 to 21. As part of House Bill 132, Session Law 100, effective October 1st, when a young adult elects to terminate the 18 to 21 agreement, the process can move forward. When DSS decides to terminate the agreement and the young person disagrees, a motion for review must be filed with the courts to make a resolution. Now, at this time, there is no criteria for what the court should consider when resolving whether to terminate the agreement or not. Now, prior law and policy allowed for both DSS and the young adult to terminate the 18 to 21 agreement. So there will be a policy change in the permanency planning manual regarding this. ICPC. As part of House Bill 132, North Carolina is still bound by the ICPC, but regulations that are created by the Association of Compact Administrators no longer have the effect of law. Now, this law change will be reflected in the Interstate Intercounty Services for Children's Manual under legal basis when we really start defining statute and policy. This is not going to have an impact on the direct practice that counties are doing with ICPC. Post-TPR review hearings. As part of House Bill 132, post-TPR review hearings are required when both parents' rights have been terminated or one person's rights were terminated and the other executed a relinquishment. Concurrent permanent plans are no longer required for post-TPR review hearings. As we are moving forward with policy, the intent is going to be to provide examples of when and if it is appropriate to have a concurrent plan at a post-TPR review hearing. Next slide. We are moving on to Session Law 2021-132, otherwise known as Senate Bill 693. So we're going to get started with diligent efforts to locate. And in this section, we are also going to discuss information about a legal custodian of a sibling and a former appropriate foster parent. This is a lot of information, so I'm going to try to take my time. A local county department of social services must make diligent efforts to locate relatives and other persons with legal custody of a sibling for a juvenile in non-secure custody within 30 days of the child's removal from their parent. County child welfare agencies are going to be required to provide those efforts to the court. The intent of the policy is going to be to ensure that county child welfare agencies are identifying and notifying all adult relatives and other persons with legal custody of a sibling. Adoptive parents of siblings are not considered relatives of the legal child. However, they must be considered in the identification and notification of individuals who have legal custody of a sibling. The intent of the policy will also be to emphasize that county child welfare agencies must thoroughly search for relatives. And like the statute said that I just mentioned, they're going to be providing those efforts to the court, but we're also going to want to see those efforts in the child welfare case record. The policy will specify, and this was a question yesterday, what I'm getting ready to discuss will be stated in policy, that the agency must first address available and appropriate relatives and whether a relative is willing and able to provide proper care and supervision for the child. If the home is assessed to be appropriate, placement must be approved by the court and designated in the court order. Placement with a legal custodian of a sibling must be considered after all relatives have been excluded. If that home is assessed to be appropriate, placement must be approved by the court and placed in the court order. Placement with non-relative kin and former appropriate foster parents must be considered after all relatives and any legal custodians of a sibling have been excluded. And if that home is assessed to be appropriate, placement must be approved by the court and designated in the court order. Next slide, please. This is still Session Law 2021-132, Senate Bill 693. The law, when we're talking about parental visits and substance abuse and drug screens, when visitation is ordered between a juvenile who is placed in or continued in the custody or placement responsibility of a county department of social services, a parent's positive result from a drug screen alone is insufficient to deny the parent court-ordered visitation, whether supervised or unsupervised. For parents with unsupervised visitation that have a positive result from a drug screen, the Department of Social Services must file a motion for review and request that a hearing be scheduled within 30 days so that the court can review that visitation plan to ensure the safety of the child. Now, while that motion is pending, the director may temporarily impose supervision requirements to all or part of the visitation plan. There is nothing in the law that prevents a visit from being canceled if, at the time that visitation between the parent and the juvenile occurs, the parent is under the influence of drug or alcohol, exhibits behaviors that may create an unsafe environment for the child, or if that parent just appeared to be actively impaired. The law change will absolutely be reflected in the permanency planning manual with the intent to emphasize that the county child welfare agency should not withhold or cease court-ordered visitation based on a parent's positive drug screen alone. The agency is going to be assessing how the positive drug screen impacts the parent and child with unsupervised visitation and assist the parent with addressing any needs identified if the county agency chooses not to alter the visitation plan prior to the hearing. If the agency is not able to address the safety issues with the parent, then the agency should reconsider whether those visits should be waived. Requirements prior to unsupervised visits. Before, and this is the law, before a county department of social services can recommend unsupervised visits with the parent from whom the juvenile was removed, a county department of social services must first observe the parent with the juvenile for at least two visits that support the recommendation. Each visit must consist of not less than 1 hour with the juvenile and must be conducted at least 7 days apart. And it also must occur within 30 days of the hearing at which the Department of Social Services makes the recommendation of unsupervised visitation. A Department of Social Services is going to be providing documentation of all the observation visits that it conducts to the court for consideration as to whether unsupervised visits should be granted to the parent from whom the juvenile was removed. And this is just like Ryland's Law, except it's for unsupervised visits. The policy is going to be reflecting what should occur prior to recommending unsupervised visitation. The county child welfare agency is going to be observing the interaction between the child and the parent and document what activities took place and how the time was spent. They're going to be observing how the parent disciplined the child, how attentive they were to the child, the affection that was displayed. And they're also going to be observing the environment in which the child is visiting and discussing and documenting any safety concerns that they observed. All of that should occur in addition to the observation requirements of the law that I just talked about. Permanency planning versus review. This is the law. North Carolina General Statute 7B906.1 states when custody has been removed from a parent, guardian, or custodian, the hearing must be designated as a permanency planning hearing. The court must conduct a permanency planning hearing within 90 days from the date of the initial dispositional hearing. Permanency planning hearings must be at least every 6 months thereafter to review the progress made in finalizing the permanent plan for the juvenile, or if necessary, to make a new permanent plan for the juvenile. If custody has not been removed from a parent, then the hearing must be designated as a review hearing. And the policy will reflect the law change regarding permanency versus review hearings and which is an appropriate tract. Agencies should also consult with their agency attorney regarding questions for when a permanency planning hearing is required versus a review hearing. And caregiver to address the court. At each hearing, the court must consider information from the parents, the juvenile, the guardian, any person with whom the juvenile is placed, the guardian ad litem, and any other person or agency that will aid in the court's review. The court must also provide any person with whom the child is placed the opportunity to address the court regarding the juvenile's well-being, though they are not necessarily granted party status as a result. The policy will reflect the law that the juvenile's caregiver should have the opportunity to address the court regarding the juvenile's well-being, and that will more than likely happen in the permanency planning manual. And I think we're ready to move to Mary.
Thank you, Scotty. My name is Mary Tor, and I am the Regulatory and Licensing Policy Consultant. And I am actually going to be covering the next section, which is about mental health services for our foster youth. Next slide, Jay. So under Session Law 2021-132, the law became effective on 8/25/2021. And it outlines the way that DSS can ensure that foster youth get the mental health services that they need. What the law says is that if a juvenile in the custody of DSS presents to the hospital emergency room for mental health treatment, the county shall contact the appropriate LME MCO within 24 hours of the determination that the juvenile should not remain at the hospital and no appropriate placement is immediately available to request an assessment. The LME must arrange for an assessment performed by either the juvenile's clinical home provider, the hospital, or other clinician within 5 business days following the notification from the director. If the assessment recommends a traditional foster home or level 1 group home, the county shall identify and provide placement within 5 business days and be responsible for providing transportation to the placement. If the assessment recommends a level of care that requires prior authorization by the LME MCO, then they are required to authorize an appropriate level of care, identify appropriate providers within 5 business days, and assign a care coordinator for the duration of services to the juvenile. The director has 5 business days from authorization and placement identification to place the juvenile. If they are unable to identify an available placement or provider, or if the assessment recommendations differ, the director shall immediately notify the rapid response team, and the rapid response team will evaluate the information provided and coordinate a response to address the immediate needs of the juvenile. So I know that was a lot of legal language, so I was going to go ahead and review it in plain English, which would hopefully be a little bit better and easier to understand. So what would happen is if a juvenile comes to the hospital emergency room, and this only applies to the emergency room at the hospital. So if a child is admitted to a mental health facility, then this law does not apply. So what happens is if little Johnny goes to the hospital because he is having a mental health crisis, and at some point in time while he's at the hospital makes a determination that he no longer needs to remain in the hospital. There's nothing medical or mental health going on that would prevent him from being discharged. At that point in time, the county director has 24 hours to contact the LME MCO to request that assessment. If the child's placement refuses to allow that child to come back, or if the DSS has not been able to find another alternative placement, that will take the child at that point in time. Once the director has contacted the LME MCO and said, we have this child, he's in the hospital, he needs to have a treatment bed, he needs an assessment done, then the LME MCO must arrange for that assessment, and they have 5 business days to do that. What is really important here is it says they must arrange for an assessment to be performed. It does not specifically say that the assessment has to be performed within 5 business days, just arranged. Then once the assessment is completed, there is the five days that the county has to identify and provide placement. If the child has a recommendation for just a traditional foster home or a traditional group home at level 1. And of course, DSS is required to transport that child to the placement. If there's any other placement that requires that prior authorization, that 5 business days is still the requirement, where the LME MCO has to authorize that appropriate level of care, identify appropriate providers within 5 business days, and assign that care coordinator within that 5 business days. Based on the comments from yesterday, just wanted to point out that what that particular portion says is that they are required to identify appropriate providers within 5 business days. It does not say that the LME MCO has to find a placement that will accept that child within 5 business days. And that's a really important distinction. I know that that the idea that the LME MCO is actually going to help find that placement, I know when I first read it through, I felt like that was a really good thing. And then, you know, upon careful reading of it, realized that that isn't exactly what it says. And then once that portion happens with the 5 business days, then the director has 5 business days from that authorization and placement identification to then place that juvenile, and the responsibility of placing the juvenile and transporting them to that foster home of a higher level is on the DSS's responsibility also. While the child is in the hospital, the DSS is required to provide ongoing case management, virtually or in person, to address the juvenile's educational and social needs during that entire time that the juvenile is in the hospital. Policy on this section is going to address the required time frames, and one of the things that they are working on is a flow chart to help better understand the time frames and what needs to happen at each point in time. I would definitely recommend that, because of the way that this law is written, that the counties actually consult with your attorney, because the way that this particular law is written is there's a lot of nuances, and the way that things are worded that would make it sound one way, but it is not exactly that requirement. And looking ahead to the future, on January 1st, 2022, there is another section to this law that becomes effective, and that talks about where if there is difficulty with the placement, a disagreement about discharge from the hospital, that a motion can be filed with the court, And DSS, the hospital, the LME MCO can make limited appearances to the court for the court to actually hear information about the juvenile's continued stay in the emergency department, or if a subsequent admission to the hospital needs to be made. And that also has financial implications for different areas, depending on what happens with that. But there will be more information that comes out about that, and that particular portion does not become effective until January 1 of next year. And I'm going to send it back to Emmy.
Thanks, Mary. I wanted to point out, since I didn't do this in the beginning, there is something in the handout pod that gives a lot of information about what was just presented. Getting some background noise. Not sure what's going on there. So we do have a legislative page fact sheet document in the handout pod that I would encourage all of you to take. It gives a lot of the information that was just presented today, so that you'll have that to take with you. And with that, this was the only item on the agenda today. So we are going to gift back 2 hours of your day. And thank you very much for joining us. We will be working on the questions that you have put in the questions pod, and we'll get those answered and sent back out to everyone who has joined us on today and yesterday's webinar. Hope you all have a great day. Thanks a lot. Bye.
Amy, did you want me to leave the webinar open for another 10 minutes for questions?
Let's do that. Give people an opportunity to write any more questions they have. We'll leave it open for about 10 minutes.
Okay, thank you.